resolutions? Is that something you normally do or something you normally avoid? Recently, I saw a cartoon that had a picture of a family, mother, father, son, and daughter, and they're all sitting around the kitchen table, and the father says, well, here we are in a brand new year. I think we should all make some resolutions, don't you? The mother says, okay, I resolve to not criticize, to nag less, and to bake more often. Family responds, yay, great. Father says, I resolve not to lose my temper and to finally fix all those things around the house that need repair. Family responds, terrific, amen. The daughter says, I resolve to keep my room clean and not to fight with my brother. Family responds, fantastic. Finally, the son says, I resolve to hang out with my buddies, to watch more TV, and to eat lots of junk food. There's a little bit of an awkward silence for a moment, and the mother says, hey, wait a minute, you know, we all made real promises. Your resolutions are worthless. To which the son replies, yeah, I know, but at least mine will actually be kept. Making and keeping New Year's resolutions is not easy stuff. A recent survey revealed that 76% of Americans never make any New Year's resolutions at all for exactly this reason. They never seem to be able to keep them. 67% of all resolutions made not being kept throughout the year, and of that 67%, 52% not even being kept for 1 week. Not particularly encouraging statistics. However, in the survey, one number that caught my attention, that was that 21% of those who said that they make New Year's resolutions said that at some point in their life, they had made a resolution that they had kept permanently and that it changed their life for the better. Now, this is hardly a great number, but I think it is a sign of a great hope. For it tells us that while keeping one's resolutions may be far from easy, it is possible. It is possible to improve one's life by choosing that life. And that it is, in fact, important to do so. The new life doesn't just happen. It has to be decided for. It has to be chosen. And this is what I'd like to focus on this morning. Today, as we gather for worship for the first time in the new year, it's a time to look back on the year past and to reflect. But even more, a time to look forward to the year ahead and to plan. As a congregation, what sort of year would we like to have? As individual disciples, how might our lives be better than we were? What course will we set out on? New Year's is a great time because it sort of naturally forces us into thinking about how we would like to be made new. Now, besides all the normal resolutions, you know, lose weight, try to get in better shape, break some habit or whatever, what sort of resolutions might we make that would really change our lives for the better? You know, maybe this is exactly the problem with so many of our New Year's decisions. They're often so superficial that even if we keep them, they don't really add up to much, and so we don't really have a lot of motivation, and so we fail. While there are other truly significant decisions we could make, which even if we fail at them, even just the slightest attempt would result in some sort of improvement, and thus we would have some real drive. And this is what I'd like to look at. Some substantial resolutions, some decisions and choices that can really improve one's life. I'd like to look at some discipleship resolutions for Christians, which is what our text this morning is all about. In our reading today, Paul is writing to the members of the church in Rome, and Paul here presents them with just some basic instruction in Christian living, a whole big collection of general rules of the Christian life, in effect, some resolutions that every Christian ought to make. He tosses out a whole variety of instructions here, almost at random, it seems. But there are a handful of general categories into which his thoughts can sort of be gathered, and what I call the four basic resolutions every Christian ought to make. Resolution number one, be special. Paul begins by saying, I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, who is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. To put this another way, the first goal Paul presents to us is to have one's life changed over, transformed, he says, so that it's not something ordinary and common, but instead something unique and valuable, something special that really makes a difference. This should be coming more in line with the will and ways of God. Essentially, he says that our first goal is to become more and more the instruments of God's work. You know, it's kind of like Jesus said, you know, you are the light of the world, you are the salt of the earth. The call to be special people, bringing that particular flavor of God, unique instruments of God in this world through which God's presence is realized. Simply put, often our lives stink simply because we just fail to be special. We end up just like everybody else. This, Paul says, should be our first resolution to be God's special people in this world. And this, as we will see, is the basis of all that follows of becoming the special instruments of God's work. But in this first part, Paul begins by offering us a couple of basic instructions of how to bring this about. First, he says, present your bodies as a living sacrifice. That is, Paul is reminding us that if you really want a better life, if you really want this better life in God, some sacrifices have to be made. Certain things we just can't have, that we have to let go of. Let's face it, a lot of times we want God, we just don't want to give up other stuff, and it doesn't work. What sort of things are getting in the way of God in our lives that we need to let go of this year? Building upon this, Paul then secondly says, do not be conformed to this world. That is, far too often our problem is simply that we want too much the ways of this world. We buy into its values, its ways. We fail to be anything special because we conform rather than transform. You know, there's an old proverb that says, if you lie down with dogs, you'll get up with fleas. Too often, we're lying down with the world. Flea-bitten Christians who nobody can tell from non-Christians. Thirdly, and most importantly, however, Paul tells us that we need to make full use of our gifts. And this is the one piece that I'd most like to focus on here. Paul says something about this very specific. He says, for by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, to not think of yourselves more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function, so we who are many are one body in Christ, and individually we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. Prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the exhorter in exhortation. Now, this is one of those places where Paul's sort of stream of consciousness writing gets a little bit muddy. But basically, his argument here is this. He's basically saying, each one of us has God-given abilities. But too often, we Christians, we just sit around criticizing one another. Acting all high and mighty, spending all our time complaining about this person or that person, not doing what we think they ought to be doing, not doing their Christian work. But the fact is that everyone has a different job, has different gifts in God. You can't compare one to another. The only real question is, how well am I doing my job? How well am I using my gifts? This is the primary component of Paul's first resolution, being made special for God, to make full use of our gifts. Understand, each one of us has been given a distinct set of abilities to which has been added a unique set of life experiences, and each week, each one of us has a one-of-a-kind collection of encounters. Put this all together, and these are our gifts, the unique gifts we have that no one else has that we can offer to God. How are we failing to use fully our gifts, either because we're afraid of what it might really ask of us, or because we don't really think we need to, that what we have doesn't really matter, or that our gifts are ours to do with as we wish, not that they belong to God, or because in comparing our gifts to others, we don't think we have it, and in all this, thus losing the life God is seeking. Paul's first point essentially is that everyone has gifts. Some may seem great, some may seem small, but all are needed. Yours are needed. And it is only in making full use of these things we ever realize the special life God wants and needs and hopes for us. Consider the following parable about the church. There once was a person who had a dream in which they pictured a carpenter's workshop in which the tools were having a conference, the Methodist, carpenter workshop, obviously. Brother Hammer presided. Several suggested that he leave the meeting because he was so noisy, always banging on things. Brother Hammer said, well, if I have to leave, then Brother Woodscrew must go also. You have to turn him around and around again to get him to accomplish anything. Brother Woodscrew spoke up, well, if you wish, I will leave, but Brother Plain must leave also. All his work is just on the surface. His efforts have no depth. Brother Plain responded, okay, but Brother Yardstick will also have to withdraw, for he is always just measuring folks and says that he's the only one who knows what's right. Brother Yardstick complained against Brother Sandpaper. You ought to leave too, because you're so rough, and always rubbing people the wrong way. In the midst of all this discussion, in walked the carpenter of Nazareth. He had arrived to start his day's work. Putting on his apron, he went to the bench to make a pulpit from which to proclaim the gospel. He employed the hammer, the wood screw, the plane, the yardstick, sandpaper, and all the other tools. And after the day's work, when the pulpit was beautifully finished, Brother Saul arose and remarked, brethren, I observe that all of us are workers together with the Lord. Let's quit complaining and each just do our job. Resolution number one, be someone special this year. Someone whose life makes a unique and priceless contribution. Think about what is unique to you and offer that to God. You know, by making necessary sacrifices, by not conforming to the world, and by using fully your gifts. Resolution number one, be someone special. Then resolution number two, be loving. Paul goes on. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Paul's second instruction is to be loving, and this, of course, is the heart of Christian life. We need to resolve to be a loving people, remembering that true love is not, properly, it's not simply an emotion, but far more, it's a constant decision. Sometimes you feel it, sometimes you don't, but love is a decision. Paul offers us a couple of very interesting instructions on how to keep this resolution. First, notice that he says, let love be genuine. In other words, it should be put on or phony. And how often is our Christian love somewhat false, you know? Either an outright being deceptive, saying we're speaking kindly to someone, right? While behind their back somewhere else we're criticizing them or gossiping about them. Or even more often, genuinely saying that we care. We're generally meaning it, but then failing to follow through on our words. Now, we all do this at times. We speak love for one another, but then we get caught up in our own issues and forget. You know, like you say, I'll pray for you, and then do we? You know? It's not love. Love must first be genuine. Just real. Be real for whatever it is. How has our Christian love been fun? Secondly, though, Paul then says we need to love one another with mutual affection. That phrase, mutual affection, means a sharing of feeling. As Paul goes on to say just a little bit later in the same passage, he says, rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those who weep. This, I believe, is a far too often overlooked aspect of Christian love. The real love is simply a sharing of life. How often does someone come to us who is happy, but we fail to really share that joy, either because we're jealous of their good fortune, or because we're simply too wrapped up in our own troubles to rejoice, you know, that's not true love. Conversely, how often in times of hardship do we forget that what a hurting person most often needs is not answers or solutions or religious platitudes, but simply someone who will sit there silently and share their struggles, you know? Real love is secondly a share. Are we offering this? Thirdly, and most especially, though, in this discussion of love, Paul says that we ought to outdo one another in showing honor. You know? And this, I believe, is the most forgotten piece of true love. It's showing honor. That is, treating one another with basic dignity and consideration and respect. Simply put, how often do we run roughshod over those we claim to love? Our family, our friends, our co-workers, our fellow church members. We allow harsh words to be spoken, unfeeling actions, no honoring, no just basic respect. Love begins and ends right there. You know, I remember once reading this story about this married couple who one day were just sitting around talking, and the husband said to the wife, tell me, dear, before me, have you ever been in love before? And the woman thought for a moment, and then she replied, well, no, darling. I once admired a man for his great intelligence. I once esteemed another man for his remarkable courage. I once was captivated by yet another man for his tremendous good looks. And I once deeply respected still another man for his strong convictions. But with you, well, how else could I explain it but love? It's far too common. It's love without respect. Right? It's wrong, and it's not love. If you don't respect someone, you don't love them. Love has that at its core, respect. Resolution number two, be loving. Genuine, sharing, and showing honor always to all. Which leads us into resolution number three, be enthusiastic. Once again, Paul writes, do not lag in zeal, be ardent in the spirit, serve the Lord. Here, of course, what Paul is talking about is Christian service. He goes on to mention, you know, in verse 13, he says, contribute to those in need, that is, give. Don't just hoard your possessions for yourself. He talks about extending hospitality to strangers, that is, being welcoming and inviting a warm person who people like to be around, who people really like to be around us. And that's a key thing that Paul works into here. Key pieces of Christian service. But in all this, Paul's main point about this is about being enthusiastic about this work. Don't lag, he says. How often are we always sort of hanging to the rear, right? Trying to do the minimal possible, hoping someone else will do the real work of Christ. Be ardent in the Spirit, he says. Literally, be on fire. He's saying, be on fire for Jesus Christ. Third resolution Paul calls all Christians to make, be enthusiastic. Be enthusiastic about serving the Lord. Don't always be the one trying to do the least for God, sitting in the back of the classroom hoping the teacher doesn't call on you. No, try to be the one trying to be called on, sitting up front with a hand up, ready to go. Be competitive even. Paul says, outdo one another. Outdo one another in showing honor. You know, this is one of the places where being competitive is a good thing. How often are we competing for the wrong things, you know? Basically, don't always be trying to avoid service, waiting to be called on, trying not to be called on, always seeking to somehow be outside the circle, you know, of where the action is, you know? Instead, be out there actively searching for opportunities to serve. As someone once said, acquire enthusiasm, for you cannot be enthusiastic and unhappy at the same time. If you resolve to be enthusiastic rather than grudging about serving the Lord, you can't help but be blessed incredibly in this year ahead. A great preacher once said to his congregation, if just 1/100th of what we believe in Jesus Christ is true, we ought to be 100 times more excited than we are. Third resolution, to be more excited about our work in Jesus Christ this year. And how does one do this? Well, I think that the key piece is in keeping a sense of the great importance of what it really means to be serving Jesus Christ. That anything we do for God is vital and it's priceless. Too often we lose sight of this. You know, it's like there's an old story from the Middle Ages, and it's told of an architect who had been hired to build a new church in France, and he went out one day to see how the laborers felt about their work, and he approached the first worker and he asked, what are you doing? What, are you blind? The worker snapped back, I'm cutting these impossible boulders with these primitive tools and putting them together the way I've been told to. I'm sweating under the blazing sun. It's back-breaking work, and it's boring me to death. The architect quickly backed off, and he went to a second worker. He asked the same question, what are you doing? The second worker replied, I'm shaping these boulders into usable forms, which are then assembled according to the plans. It's hard work, and oftentimes it gets repetitive, but I earn 5 francs a week, and it supports my wife and kids. It's a job, and it could be worse. Finally, the architect went to a third laborer, and once again he asked, what are you doing? Can't you see, said this laborer as he joyfully lifted his arms to the sky, I'm building a cathedral to glorify God. Some know only drudgery every day, but others see their work for God, and such it is for us. Every day is not just a series of encounters and tasks, it is an opportunity to get in on something fantastic that God is doing in the world and in somebody's life. See your life this way, you know? Resolution number 3, be enthusiastic. Always keep sight of what God's really trying to do in and through you every day. And then finally, resolution number 4, be strong. Paul writes, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. This is Paul's final point in this great chapter. Basically stand strong against evil. For this, he makes this foundational point a little bit earlier. He says, hate what is evil and hold fast to what is good. Many translate this as run from evil and cling to what is good. By the way, basically the point here is take evil's desire to ruin your life seriously. Don't mess around with it. Don't toy with it. Run away from it and cling tightly to goodness. Evil will try to rip it from you. This is such a major point that we also often miss, and it leads to ruin. We don't take a serious enough stance against the forces that seek to destroy our lives every day, that seek to thwart the blessings God is trying to work. Paul says, resolve to run from evil and hold fast to good. And from this foundation, Paul then delves into the 2 ways that the destructive force of evil can manifest itself within one's life and how to deal with it. Paul first says that he talks about the evil in difficult times. He says, rejoice in hope, be patient in suffering, persevere in prayer. In other words, the basic rule here is in difficult times is to be steadfast, persistent, and faithful. God will come through for those who stick to God. From this then, difficult times, secondly, then there's also difficult people. And this is the whole close of the chapter for Paul. How to deal with the evil, the destructive force at work within difficult people. And Paul offers some great advice on this. First, he says, bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Another way of putting this is, don't be nasty to the people who are rotten to you, the people you can't stand. Make them a ministry. Work and pray that they may be blessed. He then continues, do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought of what is noble in the sight of all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. That is, don't take the low road. Don't be vengeful. Let God take care of any judgment that has to happen. It's not our job. And then finally, Paul says, if it is possible, so far as it depends upon you, live peaceably with everyone. This is so important. Notice Paul's point. In effect, what he's saying is that some people are just going to be rotten to you. They're just going to be rotten to you. You're never going to really be able to get along with them. But you keep doing. You keep doing no matter what is right. You hold up your head. So far as it depends upon you, he says. That is, none of this copping out saying, they're rotten to me, I'm allowed to be rotten back. No. So far as it depends upon you, he says. Notice in all this, what Paul's reoccurring theme is, that you can overcome evil in your life, in no matter what form it comes, the evil that seeks to take away the good life that God wants for you, you can overcome it if you will just stick to what is good. But life is not that complicated. Stay with the game plan. Stay with the game plan of love in Jesus Christ, no matter how the game goes. Resolution number 4, be strong this year. Battle evil. Defeat the evil at work in and around you with good. Stay with God's ways no matter how life goes. With difficult people, swamp them with kindness. With difficult situations, insist that some sort of a blessing or purpose come out of it, you know? Evil wants to use life's difficulties against you. But don't be frightened. Just resolve to stand strong against him, opposing the destructive forces of evil, and God will come through to you. Just stick with God's word. Christian author Cynthia Kersey offers the following illustration, and she writes, every week, Linda Bremner sends 1,000 letters to children she doesn't know. Some parents might not like their children getting letters from a stranger, but not these moms and dads. They write back to thank her, and so do the kids. Linda's letters gave their kids hope, keep them alive a little longer, or just brighten their days when they see the postal carrier coming up the wall with the day's mail. And that's how it started, with the Daily Mail. In November 1980, Linda's 8-year-old son, Andy, was diagnosed with non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. After he returned home from his first hospital stay, he was welcomed with dozens of cards and letters from friends and relatives. No matter how bad he felt before the mailman arrived, Linda remembered, he always felt better afterwards. Inevitably, however, the flood of cards and letters tapered off, and so did Andy's cheerful spirit. Concerned, Linda mailed him a note she wrote herself and signed it, your secret pal, and Andy worked up. After that, Linda never let a day go by without putting another cheerful message in the mail for her little boy. After sending Andy letters for nearly a month, Linda found him one day drawing a picture. It was for his secret pal, he said. After putting Andy to bed that night, Linda picked up the drawing. At the bottom, he had written, P.S. Mom, I love you. He didn't know all along, sending him the letters, but that didn't matter. What mattered was that they made him happy and they lifted his spirits. And his life, unfortunately, ended 4 years later. He died on August 31st, 1984. Although I had two other wonderful children, Linda remembered, the grief and pain of losing Andy was unbearable. I felt my life was over because his was over. Sorting through her son's belongings, she found a shoebox in his closet, and inside the box was his address book, listing all the friends he had made at cancer camp not long before he died. And the address book gave Linda the idea that Andy would have liked her to be a secret pal to his sick friends the way she had been to him. She decided to send one card to each child in Andy's book, and before she'd gotten through the whole list, one 12-year-old boy wrote back to thank her, and in his letter he told her, I didn't think anyone even knew I was alive. And these words made Linda realize, you know, someone else was hurting as much as she was. And just after responding to that boy's letter, she received a similar note from another child on Andy's list, and that was it. She had found her calling, a purpose that gave her a passion and a meaning and a real joy in her life, and she vowed then to write to any child who needed her until they stopped writing her back. Her cards and letters are brief, positive, and always personalized. The children responded continually, and the parents did too, each thanking her for renewing life in their child. Linda got friends and neighbors to help with her mission, others got caught up with it, and an organization of letter writers began to form, and they named their new group Love Letters Incorporated. Today, Love Letters Incorporated sends out more than 60,000 pieces of mail a year. 35 volunteers collectively contribute 400 hours for each weekly mailing. As much as she gives, Linda Bremner receives more in return, a reason for living, and an inner peace that overcomes her own grief and pain. Says Linda simply, "I have seen a child cry, and I have seen a child smile. I like the smiles, and it's really important to me to know that I helped make one today." Evil had sought to destroy her life, but she gave her struggle to the Lord and overcame evil with good by standing strong against it. The story is told that at the beginning of a new year, a high school principal once decided to post his teacher's New Year's resolutions on the bulletin board. As the teachers gathered around the bulletin board, a great commotion suddenly started. One of the teachers was very upset and complaining. "Why aren't my resolutions posted?" she angrily whined. "This is an insult." She was throwing such a tantrum that the principal hurried to his office to see if he had overlooked her resolutions, and sure enough, he had mislaid them on his desk. He rushed back to post them. They read, "Number one, don't let little things bother me so much." And number two, "Be more forgiving." Making and keeping New Year's resolutions, it is tough stuff. But a new, better life doesn't just happen. It has to be decided for. It has to be chosen. What sort of life will we choose in the year ahead? The four basic resolutions every Christian ought to make. Be special. Be loving. Be enthusiastic. And be strong.